Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Beaches, Bungalows, and Burglaries by Tonya Kappes, narrated by Johanna Parker. 1. A campground? I gulped back a good hissy fit, because no one could ever underestimate the power of a good hissy fit, something I've tried really hard not to do in years.
As in tiny little metal houses and porta-potties?
Well, I think they have a toilet in them,
said Stanley Shelton, my lawyer. He eased back in his big, fancy, wing-back leather chair, with his elbows resting on the wooden arms and his fingers drumming against each other. The gray, pinstriped suit was of the finest materials, and the nice crystal cufflinks were the touch it needed that screamed successful lawyer.
I think the toilet is small, but you're small.
He rubbed his hand over his bald head and then proceeded to draw his hand over his mustache and beard. I tried as hard as I could to keep it together, but my composure was under attack.
What about my house in the Hamptons? I'll just go there.
I let out a sigh of relief. It was a perfect plan.
I'm desperately going to miss the New York City apartment, but I need a break.
Unfortunately, it wasn't going to change the fact that my now ex-husband was in jail for a Ponzi scheme. He kept me busy by sending me to the spa, salon, and shopping for most of our 2-year marriage. Not to mention, I'd cashed out my 401k to help him start a side business where he said we'd be partners. Little did I realize it was partners in a crime.
And the house is gone.
Stanley's jaw set.
I'm going to need the keys to your car and trade you for these.
He dangled a very small key from a flamingo keychain in the air.
What's that? A moped key? I joked.
It's to your house and your new car.
He glanced out the window of his fancy office that was filled with plaques and certificates that boasted of his high education.
You can't even look at me? Because I clearly remember when we were donating to your son-in-law's election fund and visiting our friends in the community who ended up being big donors, that you had no issue looking at me. And now that my bank account has taken a hit, you won't even look at me?
I questioned with a slight bitter taste in my mouth.
It didn't take a hit. There's no bank account. The FBI seized it all.
Stanley made no effort to make me feel the slightest bit better about my situation.
Where is my new house? The Upper East Side? Not that that's a bad place to live, but not like where we live now.
He licked his lips.
Out there.
He pointed to the window. I sat up a little straighter in my chair and leaned on the arm of the leather chair.
There's nothing out there but an RV, a small one at that.
I laughed and eased back into the chair.
Wait, you mean that?
My voice trailed off when I noticed he didn't find amusement in my teasing about the camper.
I'm afraid that there's no money to give you. The only thing free and clear are the camper and the campground.
He stood up and walked around the desk. He eased down on the edge.
I'm sorry, May. You don't deserve this.
Are you sure? I asked. I mean, I was having a real bad day before I got here, but this just made it almost unbearable.
I rested my elbow on the arm of the chair and covered my mouth with my hand. I twisted my head to the side so Stanley couldn't see my tearing up. There was a glimpse of my silhouette in the door of the mini refrigerator. My hazel eyes were sunken with half-moon dark circles under them. I'd not taken the time to straighten my long brown curly hair, and the humidity in the air wasn't making it any better.
May?
Stanley said my name. I blinked a few times.
I didn't recognize the image staring back at me. Sorry,
I apologized and forced a demure smile.
I was having a hard time wrapping my head around the fact that I had nothing, no family, no marriage. No place to live, no car, nothing. I mean, Paul is a jerk, and I'd like to kill him, but he left me with nothing?
I hugged my designer bag to my chest.
That scum. I couldn't believe that I was so dumb that I put everything in his name.
He owed a lot of people money, and some still don't have their retirement back. You're lucky I could salvage this in the settlements, since he did have it in your name alone.
He sounded as if I needed to thank Paul. Stanley picked the flamingo keychain up and once again stuck it in my face.
The campground is in Normal, Kentucky.
Kentucky? My jaw dropped. You mean I have to go there? My mind rolled back to the last time I was in Kentucky. It was 2:04 a.m. I knew the exact time because it was the time I was born and also my 18th birthday. It was the day I grew up and knew that no one was going to give me a free ride. Somehow, Paul made me feel safe and secure. Until now.
You have to go there and be the manager if you want to have some sort of income, or we can look at selling the place.
He didn't move those darn keys. I didn't even know about this campground. I shook my head, refusing to take the keys. I've certainly never been a manager of a campground.
When Paul was in college, he somehow ended up at this campground and winning some silly bet. After the two of you were married, he had me put the deed in your name and your name alone. The FBI couldn't seize it.
Stanley thumbed through some papers on his desk. Lucky me, I groaned.
You have a camper to live in and a way to acquire some income.
He pushed himself up off the desk and put a hand on my shoulder.
I suggest you take a trip. Make it an adventure. Check the place out and save up a couple of months before you decide if you want to sell it or not.
He held out a brochure that had Happy Trails written in big letters across the top. There was a beautiful, bright, and vibrant photo on the front that looked more like a vacation spot than a campground. Adventure? I cocked a brow and looked back out the window at the camper. Yellow? I questioned the color on my home on wheels. I don't even like yellow.
It's a pop-up. The top lifts to make more space. There's a kitchen, bedroom, bathroom, and you can drive it. It's perfect,
he said with an upbeat tone.
Be sure you read the manual in the glove box on how to work all the equipment. It can be tricky.
Are you really trying to sell me on this camping idea? I lived in a 10,000-square-foot home with a house cleaner. I drive a Maserati. Drove. I gripped the keys of my little car in my hand. I looked down and opened my palm. Did drive a Maserati? I gulped back the tears and practically ripped the flamingo keychain out of his hand.
I'm sorry to cut this short, but I've got to get to court.
He took his hand off my shoulder and put it in his pant pocket, pulling out $100 bill.
Here, this is for gas and food. I can feel the bones in your shoulder. Eat.
No. I shook my head and stood up, a bit wobbly. I'm fine. I don't need a handout. He didn't take no for an answer. He stuck the money in my palm and curled my fingers around it.
Let me know when you get to Kentucky.
He smiled and patted my hand before he dropped it. His eyes softened.
May, I'm sorry. Out of all my clients' wives, you've always been so kind and nice. I know this whole process has made you bitter and hard-hearted, but I know you're strong and we'll figure this all out.
Thanks, Stanley. I sucked in a deep breath. You've been great. I know I sound like some spoiled brat, but I think I'm still in shock having been in this nightmare for only 3 months.
I sent some of your things to the campground. There's even a storage facility on the grounds. The current manager knows you're coming. I put a file in the camper with her name on it and some information about the campsite.
He patted my back.
I suggest you not even look at it until you get there, so you can focus on your new adventure the next couple of days.
Couple of days? That's how long it'll take to drive to Kentucky? I questioned, clearly not remembering how long it took the Greyhound to drive here years ago.
In a camper? Yes.
He walked over to the door and opened it.
Let me know if there's anything I can do for you.
You've done enough, keeping me out of jail.
I started to tear up, my voice cracked.
I can't thank you enough.
I walked out the door, knowing that I'd never see Stanley again. The past few months, I'd seen him practically every day. When the FBI had shown up at our house that morning of the raid, I'd never forget. Stanley came right to the jail and bailed me out. We left Paul in there. He deserved it. It took a lot for Stanley to prove that I'd not signed any of the paperwork, and Paul had forged my name, but Stanley did it. I'm forever grateful. The long walk down the hall of his office was a blur. I was numb. I remember pushing open the door of his office building and stepping out into the bright sunshine. I pulled my sunglasses down on my nose and pushed them up. My eyes slid over to the cute little black convertible that was my birthday gift last year when I turned 30. Little did I realize it was bought with other people's money Paul had schemed them out of from our fake partnership. I slid my eyes over to the bright yellow camper and then down at the flamingo keychain. I guess it could be much worse, I grumbled, and took my first steps toward my new reality as I tried to keep an upbeat attitude. 2. The day I drove out of my lawyer's parking lot and into the small southern town of Normal, I should have known then that nothing was going to be normal. Never, ever again was anything going to be normal. Before Paul, I was what you'd call a pretty normal person with a regular job as a flight attendant. I worked every shift at the airport I could and had a roof over my head. When I met Paul 5 years ago, I was 25. That's when I began to live his life with all of his lavish things. I'd gotten used to it pretty quickly, and the finer things just became part of my identity. Everyone thought I was a gold digger, since Paul was a 61-year-old bachelor that had never been married. I wasn't. I truly fell in love with the Paul that I knew. I should have known something was wrong the night before the FBI showed up at our house. Paul had said something funny, like if something were to happen to him, he had me a special present in the sock drawer. I didn't know what that had meant. The FBI raided the house, and there was literally nothing in the sock drawer. But there was something in the secret sock drawer compartment that the FBI didn't find. It was $100,000 in cash, with a note from Paul that said the money was from my 401k that we'd cashed in. Little did I realize that he'd cashed it in to help fund his little crime. You can bet that I didn't turn that money in, though I probably should have. I convinced myself it was my 401k that he took from me. When it quickly dawned on me that my world was no longer in existence, I knew I had to make that money last. And this RV? What was I going to do with that? First off, I had no idea how to drive it. I didn't realize the toilet was just a hole that had to be cleaned out, which I can't believe there's not been an invention improving upon this. Regardless, I made it to Normal, Kentucky in a couple of days, like Stanley had predicted. I did what Stanley suggested and focused on getting to Kentucky while the other things worked their way out in my head. In fact, after taking a look at the brochure of the campground, I got a little excited. It was actually a little paradise, with a big fishing lake where there appeared to be a beach to lie out. I could stand to use a little color, and with summer fast approaching, this was exactly what I needed. Now, there was no denying that I was definitely going to sell it, but like Stanley said, while he found a buyer, I could just go check it out and see what I thought. From the photos, it was an upscale campsite. The latest craze for people in their 20s was to live with less and explore more, which could be a good thing for business. The brochure also showed a little tiki bar near a lake with a lot of people mingling around with smiles on their faces. It was a perfect place for me to go relax for a couple of months. Like Stanley said,
It was easy income, with everyone paying me a lot fee each month. It appeared to be run like a well-oiled machine. The financial reports showed that there wasn't much money in the account, and only two employees, but it looked like I could cut back on a few things, because the place looked perfect. I'm sure Dottie Swaggart, the property manager, was going to be very helpful in getting my feet wet. So many things rolled around in my head, and firing Dottie was one of them. But why would I do that when I was going to sell it anyways? It didn't appear that her salary was that much. I decided that any big decisions that needed to be made would be after I'd been there and taken in a few rays by the sparkling lake. This is way out here, I talked to myself after I'd driven out of town and into the country, hugging a few of the curvy roads that tickled my stomach. The entrance should be here somewhere. I leaned over the big steering wheel and looked out of the windshield. Happy Trails Campground. I read the faded words on a piece of propped-up wood that looked as if it had once arched over the entrance, like the one in the brochure. Pushing back the notions that this was a sign of what the campground looked like in person, I forged ahead, figuring they were in the process of having a brand new sign installed. If not, it'd be the first thing on my list. The folder Stanley had given me was in the middle console between me and the passenger seat. I grabbed it. I wrote down a list of to-dos, and repainting or buying a new sign was the first thing that would go on that list. And pavement, I murmured to myself as I wrote down a second to-do after the ticking sound of the gravel spitting up underneath the tires of the camper caught my attention. No one likes gravel. It was just a minor detail. I wasn't going to let spoil my much-needed vacation in my fancy campground. At least Paul had done something right by me. The sun was shining, and the backdrop of the Daniel Boone National Park made up for an ugly sign. I couldn't wait to park this thing and plop down into a lawn chair next to the lake and let the bright sun warm my face. That'd make me feel a little better. I was sure of it. Pulling onto the grounds itself, I could see that there were plenty of trees for shade. There were storage units on the right, like Stanley had said. The brochure did say that campers who were here an extended time were able to rent those, which probably brought in more income for me. There was a small building in front of the storage units with peeling letters on the glass door that read, Office. That just needs a little cleaning, I said, stopping the RV in front of it before I wrote that on the list. A little further down was a community recreation room, exactly like the brochure had said, though it needed a good coat of paint or a bulldozing down. Either way, it too had to be a minor detail. A detail that I didn't think was so minor was the lush green Kentucky bluegrass that I'd read about and seen in the photos in the brochure that was in reality brown and burnt looking. Am I at the right place? I questioned and picked up my phone to make sure the GPS had taken me to the right place. I guess so. I shrugged and wrote down that I might need to get some sod. Driving a little further and around what was supposed to be the lake and tiki bar, there were a cluster of rundown cabins. I brought the camper to an abrupt halt after I'd made the complete loop around the grounds. My jaw dropped. I picked up the brochure from the passenger seat and looked back and forth. No! I just couldn't believe my eyes. I shoved the gear shift into park. The entire Happy Trails campground was nothing like the brochure. The tiki bar consisted of two posts and a wood plank across them with a caved-in roof. Not the plush and vibrant bar with stools and little lights and people smiling. I gulped. My eyes slid across the lake and the beach. Again, I referred back to the brochure. The glass blue lake with the people hanging out on the dock with their toes dipped in and a smile on their face, a fruity drink next to them, and lawn chairs along the beach was nowhere in sight. I was looking at a green film floating on top of a mucky brown piece of water with a small dock that had missing planks. There wasn't a single lawn chair on the dry dirt. I looked up and around. In the distance and off a couple of different roads, there were concrete pads with some grass between them. Some of the lots were filled with campers, and some were empty. According to the brochure, all the lots were filled with happy campers, twinkling lights, and smiling people. Where were my people? I gulped. Where were the crazy designed, twinkly lights people hung outside of their campers? My heart dropped into my gut. I should have known this wasn't going to pan out, and Paul screwed me again. Just as I was about to jerk the gear shift into drive and get out of Dodge, someone banged on the RV door. Knock, knock. My nerves were shot. I fumbled to unbuckle the seatbelt, hopped over the console into the living part of the camper, and pushed the door open. What do you want? The voice was hidden by a puff of smoke. You almost gave me a heart attack on top of the one I'm currently having, I yelled, trying to see through the smoke. There was a fairly older woman standing about 5'9", with pink foam curlers clipped all over her red hair. Her green satin pajamas matched her fuzzy slippers.
I'm Dottie Swaggart. What'll I do you for?
She asked, and took a long, slow drag from the cigarette in her right hand, while her left hand rested on her jutted-out hip.
Is this Happy Trails Campground? I asked.
The sun beat down on me when I stepped out of the camper.
Mm-hmm.
She drew in a big breath. The coals at the end of her cig lit up bright red like her hair color as she sucked in.
One and only?
She stared at me from behind a puff of smoke.
In normal Kentucky?
I fanned my hand in front of me so she didn't get her smoke in my face or my house on wheels.
One and only.
She chomped on a piece of gum and smoked at the same time. She put her fingers with her cig stuck between them up to her temple. She closed her eyes.
Let me think.
She tapped her head.
You must be Mae West.
Oh, gosh.
My stomach nodded. My go-get'em attitude was wavering. I reached over the back of the passenger seat and grabbed the brochure.
Where is this, Happy Trails?
I shook the brochure at her.
Honey, you look as confused as a cow on astroturf,
she cackled.
What? I questioned. What does a cow and astroturf have to do with anything?
They are gonna eat you alive,
she said in smug delight.
Paradise awaits.
Dottie's lip cocked up on the right side as she smacked her gum and swept her hands out in front of her.
It's all yours.
She turned around and laughed like a mad woman on her way to a small trailer that didn't have a way to drive. It looked like it was just plopped down, and the trailer hookup was casually resting on two cinder blocks.
Dottie, wait,
I hollered, kicking dust up under my feet as I chased her.
This isn't right. This isn't what the brochure shows.
I let the part about being eaten alive just wash over me. Dottie Swaggart was someone I needed at this moment, and fussing with her wouldn't do me any good.
Honey, that brochure was printed well over 20 years ago when it was booming around here. The national park is still going strong, and when tourists come to town, they take one look at Happy Trails and hightail it on out of normal, finding a campground in another town.
She dropped her cigarette on the ground and used the toe of her shoe to snuff it out. She turned back around, walking to the camper.
Where's the Kentucky Bluegrass? We are in Kentucky.
I looked around with the brochure in my grips and hurried towards her. When I was a kid growing up in Kentucky, I never paid attention to the grass. I just wanted to get out of there.
Shouldn't there be the famous bluegrass?
What we got here is fine Kentucky dirt.
She bent down and picked up a handful of the driest soil.
We like to sprinkle it around like fairy dust and make wishes.
She threw it in the air, letting out a big cackle.
You're teasing me, right? I wasn't sure how to take Dottie.
You are a city girl,
she said to herself, like she was confirming her immediate perception of me. She continued, in a fast-paced walk, towards her camper.
We can fix it back up in a couple of weeks.
I waved the brochure in the air, running after her, feeling somewhat helpless.
Listen here, Mae West.
She turned to face me, stopping shy of her metal door.
You don't look like Mae West from the Wild West.
Mae is a family name, and West is my married name. If I had a dollar for everyone who'd said that to me in the last few years, I'd not be standing in a run-down campground, hoping to make a living, which was obviously on hold.
May I call you Mae?
She asked. I nodded.
There's a lot more things around here to fix than making it all prettied up like that there brochure.
She grabbed it from me and flipped it over, pointing out the copyright date from decades before.
We need to fix the washers and dryers, vending machine, clean up the lake, and did you see the dock?
I have all the financial statements. I bit my lip, my brows furrowed. All the reports show that the campground is doing good.
That obviously wasn't the case.
Mae, I figure you to be a smart girl. After what happened to you, I think you'd know that sometimes things that are on paper aren't as they really appear.
She was talking about Paul and his scheme.
Here.
She pulled a set of keys out of her pocket.
She's all yours. I've been dying to get out of this place. Plus, you had some things shipped here. I put them in the storage building over there. Number 4.
What are these?
My heart beat rapidly and my palms sweat.
Dottie?
She patted her dirty old camper.
Them there are the keys to all the locks on the outbuilding and the storage units.
She gestured to them.
That sweet husband of yours didn't pay me the last couple of years. He said that I could live in this junker for free. I'm happy to give you the keys and make you in charge.
She opened the door.
I'll only be a second to grab my underwear, and you can move right on in.
She reopened the door and went inside.
Wait, no, that's not what I mean.
My mouth dried because all my saliva had apparently flooded my eyes.
I can't do this anymore. I hate you, Paul West.
I dropped to the ground, not worried if I'd fallen into one of Dottie's cigarettes or whatever else was on the dirt ground. But I'd had enough. I was broken, and nothing was going to fix me. I buried my head in my hands and sobbed.
Did you say you hate Paul West?
She popped her head out the door.
Yes, I hate him. I hate this place.
I sobbed.
Well, you just might fit right on in here after all. We all hate Paul West around here.
Dottie held the door open and waved me in.
You know he's a liar.
Oh, I'm aware. Look at me.
I pointed to my curls that had gotten worse since I stepped out of the RV. The humidity wasn't doing me any favors.
I'm so overdue for a highlight. And look at my nails.
I wiggled them in front of my face and showed her the chipped up mess that was at least 2 weeks overdue.
I've got someone that can fix you right up.
She picked up a strand of my hair.
This is the least of your problems. Coffee?
Yes, that'd be great.
I nodded. The door slammed shut, making me jump.
Get on in here.
She held the camper screen door open.
Do you live here?
I asked and looked around as I took a seat at one of the kitchen chairs. The inside was what I'd expected to see. Fun pineapple party lights strung up all over the back of the couch along the back wall. The kitchen flowed from there. She had a small cafe table and the 2 chairs right across from the kitchenette where she was filling up 2 white coffee cups. She sat a cup in front of me.
Creamer? Sugar?
She asked.
No, this is good.
I brought the cup up to my mouth and took a sip, feeling an instant relief.
I really like your camper.
There's more to Dottie than meets the eye,
She referred to herself in third person and made me smile.
Looky there, you're smiling. Now, if you put on some lipstick, you'd be downright pretty, and find you a man to take care of you and your problems here, Mae West.
She fiddled in one of the cabinets, snapped a paper towel off the roll, and put the fingernail polish remover on the table.
That's the last thing I need. I took another sip. I've got to figure out how to get this place looking presentable, because my lawyer is looking for a buyer. No one in their right mind is going to buy this dump.
No one in their right minds parks their RV in this dump.
She read my mind.
Cheers.
We knocked cups and laughed. We talked while I took the chipped polish off my nails.
Well, we got Henry down the road. He's down yonder in the fifth wheel camper, and he's the handyman. Literally, he only maintains what we've got here. I've tried to get a hold of your husband, but he'd never return our calls. I'd gotten a lawyer if we had money, but we don't got nothing but a roof over our heads.
She got up from the chair and grabbed the carafe, refilling our mugs.
I'm all ears if you've got ideas, but I guess you're gonna make me pay rent now that you're here.
No, I shook my head. I need you, Dottie Swaggart, and I'm new to all this. I need you, Dottie, I said again so I could get my point across.
There was no reason to even bring up my past life. That was far behind me now. So was Paul West.
I was going to just keep my chin up and get this place cleaned up, even if I had to do it myself. I looked down at the brochure I'd put down on the kitchen table. If it was the last thing I ever did on this earth, and it killed me, I was going to make this place look just like the brochure, and I had a few weeks to do it. I needed all the help I could get.
Just what are you thinking? She eyeballed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.